So good evening and welcome to the new school and to the 35th conference in the social research series. Tonight's conference, you all know, is the future of scholarly knowledge, and I'm Arien Mack, and I'm a professor of psychology here at the New School and have been editor of social research for a long time. Before we would begin, I thought I would like to say a little bit about social research, a future issue of which will be devoted to the papers in this conference. Social research has been the journal of the New School for Social Research for a very long time, actually since 1934, when it was launched by the first president of the New School, Alvin Johnson. And he launched it with the small group of exiled scholars who he managed to bring out of Germany as Hitler was rising to power. That group was known as the University in Exile, and it was actually named that in 1933, so it was the University in Exile at the New School for Social Research. It became known on the very next year, 1934, it became known as the Graduate Faculty of, International Politics and Social Sciences. If somebody knows, remembers this. Dick, do you remember? Better than me. It then changed its name again much more recently, and now is simply called, what was the University in Exile is now called the New School for Social Research. And it was Johnson, the first president, who thought that division of the New School, which was then very small, should have a public voice and be concerned with public issues. And they launched social research as their journal, and it's been publishing ever since. And it was really with that in mind that we launched this conference series in, 1988. The mission from the start of these conferences has been to try to foster discussions around issues of serious public concern. All these conferences then become special issues of the journal. The forthcoming issue, the one that is coming out very soon, a little bit late, is called Failure, and it turns out to be an eerily appropriate moment to be publishing an issue on failure, it seems to me, given what's going on in this country especially. Papers from every conference are published as special issues of social research, and this one will be the fall 2017 issue and can be ordered outside at the journal table. We began this conference series in 1988, and since 2010, it has been organized under the auspices of what is called the New School Center for Public Scholarship, which is intended, at least, to be an intellectual crossroad for academics, students, policymakers, and the public, again, addressing the kind of pressing social issues. For today's conference, we have been fortunate to partner with Ken Prewitt of Columbia University, who has brought us generous funding from Sage Publications. This is really Ken's conference, and it is actually, though, the fourth of our conferences focused on issues of higher education. In 2008, we hosted our 18th conference titled Free Inquiry at Risk, Universities in Dangerous Times, and followed it up with part two in 2009 in Berlin, when we were celebrating the 75th anniversary of the founding of the University in Exile. In 2011, we organized a conference called The Future of Higher Education. All of these conferences are available as issues of the journal outside. We've examined the state of higher education in other venues as well. We have done so in four Endangered Scholars Worldwide events, including an upcoming event next month on continuing threats to academic freedom, at which four people have actually suffered from the severe limits on academic freedom and free inquiry will speak, all of them having spent time at the New School. I just wanted you to know that Endangered Scholars Worldwide is a regular feature of each issue of Social Research, and also hosts a website, an independent website, although it's part of the New School, in which which is currently constantly updated and contains information about the unfortunately all too many scholars who are imprisoned, being lost their jobs, as so many have done in Turkey very recently. And our hope is that the publicity that we try to give them will help to protect them and also will engage the people who come to the website or read the section of social research in sending letters, which we provide in asking for release of it from imprisonment and the like. We've also organized events focusing on the university in exile. The last one was keynoted by Samantha Power. And we've had an event on the state of the humanities and several events on the crises confronting higher education in the Middle East. Most recently, actually only a year ago, we held a Public Voices event titled The Problematic Future of Higher Education that Jim Miller, whom you will meet tomorrow, is moderator of the humanities panel, and Ken Prewitt, whom you will meet in a minute, unless you already know him. This conference would not have been possible without Ken Prewitt, who really shaped it. It also would not have been possible without the generous support of Sage Publications, which came through Ken. We're grateful. Now it is my privilege to introduce Ken Prewitt. Ken is the Carnegie Professor of Public Affairs and the Vice President for Global Centers at Columbia. He is also Director of the Scholarly Knowledge Project. And last but not least, this is just a fraction of what Ken is and does, he was the dean at the New School for Social Research, if only briefly, which is important to us here, but much more important to the world, he was the director of the U.S. Census. On top of all this and much more, he has written many books and articles, received many awards, and it's my pleasure to give him the microphone.
I have a number of quite small things to do before bringing our keynoter here. My first task is kind of like the announcer at the opera that comes out, you know, just as the lights go down, and says, I have to tell you that the tenor has come down with a cold and won't be singing tonight. That's not true because our keynoter is here and he will speak. However, I mention that because I do want to alert you to the fact that we did lose one of our panelists, Alan Ryan, who is very ill and could not travel across the Atlantic as he had hoped to do so. I want to mention that just because if there's some people in the audience who very particularly wanted to hear Alan speak, he will not be. On the other hand, we don't have a stand-in, but we have something better than that. Dan Kevles, who, if you see the program, the earlier version of the program, was speaking in the afternoon panel in the natural science setting, and he's actually, because he is an historian and a humanist, he is going to sort of start tomorrow morning on the humanities panel. So I just want to be square with you about where we are, so I don't want someone coming tomorrow afternoon to hear Dan and to be told, well, he spoke this morning, where were you, dummy? You know. So that's my announcement. My second task is to welcome you to the conference, add a few words to what Arien just said. It's extremely important that I emphasize that this is not about the future of higher education. It's very deliberately about the future of scholarly knowledge. There are hundreds and hundreds of conferences about higher education, its crises, its problems, its successes, its failures. It's for profits, it's non-for-profits, it's big, it's small, it's global, it's not global, et cetera. There are many, many big issues that have to be sorted out, and obviously Arien's center has been working on this. Scholarly knowledge is a piece of that, but it's a really critical piece. It's actually what places like this are about, the new school and our respective university homes. We talk about scholarly knowledge on a backdrop of some confusion about its future. For one thing, we've lost our monopoly over knowledge. We are now in competition with the McKinseys, the think tanks, the Apples, the Googles, and so forth. We watch the commercialization of knowledge, from which universities are not immune. There's a kind of contest going on between the universities and their funders on what I would call the accountability autonomy tension. How much accountability are we going to be subjected to, and who's going to be doing the subjecting, and how much autonomy do we have to teach and do our research as we wish? And the whole we swim in a world of performance metrics. So that's a big complicated landscape, and what we will do tonight and tomorrow is to try to sort out, slightly unpack it tomorrow as we separately consider the humanities, the social sciences, and the natural sciences. And that's my welcome to the conference. And I want to pause before I introduce Professor Bromwich. Look, it'd be melodramatic to ask for a moment of silence. But in a conference on, you know, public scholarship, public edification, political enlightenment, and this is what this is all about, we just have to recognize that this is a dismal moment in our societies and some other societies, where public discourse has been deliberately coarsened, where it's been deliberately fed a bunch of deceptive lies, and where it's become hurtful. Deliberately hurtful. So it's sort of a good thing we're having this conversation. The stakes are very high, I think, in terms of getting, if we don't get scholarly knowledge and the Enlightenment Project back in play in a major way, we've put in play some forces that are going to be extremely damaging to our the quality of our life, to our democracies, our economies, and so forth and so on. Arien already hinted at that. That's not what the conference is about, but it's sort of provides the deep motivation and rationale for why we have to have conferences of this sort. One of the things about that coarsening and so forth is that it's been carried out by people who call themselves public intellectuals. I'm thinking of the pundits, many of them based in think tanks, and they're worried about their future and income and so forth. They're willing to say many different kinds of things, not all of them correct or true, or worried about the quality of the stuff and so forth. And I mention that because, in some respects, we have lost a lot of our public intellectuals, those who draw from philosophy, from literature, from history. David Bromwich is one that we haven't lost. He's one that has been a really marvelous voice on the very big stage, intellectual stage, who is ruthlessly honest. And brings candor to his observations, as you no doubt will hear. Professor Brown, anybody who stands at this platform, behind this podium or wherever we're standing, later we're going to sit by the flowers. That'll be a little more cozy. We've done it all. We've gone to conferences, we've written books, we've done articles. We wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be professors at research universities if that wasn't true, and I'm not going to bother to go through that with respect to David, except to say it's broad, his intellectual reach, from romantic criticism, from poetry to music, 18th century politics, an expert on Burke. And then I draw attention to only one book, 94 book, which was an examination of higher education. He was one of the first people to really voice the critique of higher education, even from within, as well as from without, from both the left and the right. And the dangers of the erosion of critical thinking and kind of the independence of the mind from across the political spectrum. And the good news is that he brought the arguments, the sort of arguments he advanced in, in that book, now to the New Republic, to Dissent, to the New York Review of Books, to the Times Literary Supplement, to the London Review of Books, really to a world in which he himself is deeply engaged in trying to improve the quality, the depth, the rigor of public discourse about issues that that we care about. So it's my pleasure to kibitz just a bit more as you walk the up here, David. Yeah. So let's welcome David Bromwich.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here. And is the microphone about right? Everybody hears me about right? It's one of these lavalier things. Okay. In speaking on so broad a subject and weighty a subject as the future of scholarship, I have to begin with a disclaimer. Within the professional self-definitions of the humanities, and I'll be talking mainly about the humanities because it's where I come from and what I know, I'm a commentator and interpreter much more than a scholar in the textual and archival sense. I depend on the work of such scholars, and for selfish as well as public-minded reasons, I want their research to go on and be strengthened. But I'll be talking today about an older sense of scholarship, the word and the thing, which goes back to the Anglo-Saxon scolare and is, excuse me, scolare, not Latin, but Anglo-Saxon, scolare, as in Chaucer, and is simply associated with the idea of someone working and learning in a school. We've been instructed thoroughly in recent books by foundation heads and education administrators about the dominance of STEM in university budgets and its disproportionate attraction for ambitious students, the diminishment of the place of the physical library as a haunt of the learned, the eclipse of the liberal arts ideal by vocational training, and the transmission of skill sets in institutions that once would have scorned such demands. And these circumstances all make up our predicament. But I'll be talking this evening about matters more closely connected to human personality than to the size and shape of institutions. A distinct character and temper has always been required for the work we call academic or scholarly, and many conditions of the modern university seem to work against the perpetuation of that character and temper. Arien, Mack and Ken Prewitt set as a topic for this conference the tension between autonomy and accountability. That's their phrase. But what does it mean? The scholar is an individual, and yet the work that he or she does to gain legitimate self-confidence and earn the reliance of others needs checking, or what John Locke called the work of rectification. This is naturally done by a community of scholars who know the nature of the individual scholar's work. Colleagues at a distance, you might say, who often may have been consulted on the way. Such exertions of accountability, however, in our time are also performed, and in ever more minutely calibrated ways, by a machinery of oversight, which often takes the form of separate advisory committees in the divisions of the humanities, social sciences, and natural sciences, the three that will be composing day two of this conference. Those committees in turn look for guidance and rectification to external referees who are asked to rate a given scholar's work against the background of other work to which it can properly be compared. The referees are asked to employ the measure of the hypothetical or actual world-class scholar against whose typical achievements every other contribution to knowledge must be ranked. For teachers in smaller liberal arts colleges, a kindred measure is likely to be invoked, sometimes involving a heavy emphasis on student evaluations of teaching. Every idiom has its idiot, and a gain from the system I've sketched plainly is that idiocy in this literal and etymological sense is decreased. Fewer persons who now bear the name of a scholar can command a distinct and uncommunicable idiom which baffles students and colleagues alike. A desirable sort of conformity is thereby fostered, whose currency in a given discipline assures that a common body of knowledge is being referred to, and we want that. But there's a corresponding diminishment of something valuable. Let's call it idiosyncrasy or eccentricity, which is itself an element of individuality in scholarship as it is in life. The eccentric may move in overlapping regions with her colleagues, but she doesn't aspire to share their center and circumference. In a promotion review of published writings, I once heard a younger colleague's work criticized on the ground that it was orthogonal to the interests of the field. It failed to go with the flow. It crossed the familiar and recommended currents at a right angle. This was offered as a decisive criticism. But could it not equally have been a heterodox kind of praise? How much cooperation and conformity do we really want, even in scholarship undertaken in the pursuit of truth? Most people who come into possession of some power, and academic life differs little in this respect from the corporate world and politics, once their prestige is high enough, are apt to suppose their thoughts are the most congenial to the truth that matters at the moment. Disciplines are fond of those who travel in a well-worn but still new-looking groove. It may be tediously respectable like rational choice theory or carry avant-garde credentials like queer theory, but sooner or later the groove becomes a rut. And all the while, those who move along it are always saying, fail to be like us at your professional peril. They are asking scholars to trade corporate approval for self-knowledge, and I mean corporate in this usage now, simply to refer to a group. There never has been a more desolate title of a scholarly essay than The Way We Think Now. An essay by Clifford Geertz, an admirable scholar in many respects, but he was seduced by this currency ideal. Trust in the academy and therefore in the support of scholarship has waned, as our organizers remarked in their preliminary statement, and it would be hard to deny the truth of this. A self-protective reaction against the recession of support has been for the university to try to make itself more corporate, more like the world of commerce and culture outside the university, in the belief that this adaptation will induce a heightened appreciation of scholarship. I suspect the reverse is true. Though our financial betters may work in corporations, they don't always love them very much. Do they like us better for trying to resemble them? And by they, I mean the CEOs, interspersed with the occasional lawyer or distinguished alumnus or state lawmaker, who serve on boards of regents or as members of a university corporation. The truth is that college faculties were a good deal like monastic institutions, relatively speaking, some way into the 20th century. Is it altogether a good thing that they've become more like consultancies or the specialized units of research parks? Accountability by accountability by oversight has been bureaucratized within the university, and it has also come under the suspicious eye of cost-benefit accounting by external agencies. These agencies may be of the most various sorts. A pharmaceutical company that donates money to a new program in chemistry expects some return, however indirect. The Defense Department is interested in theoretical physics because it may cash out in retina scanners to be used at dangerous borders. The Civil Rights Division of the Department of Education believes in racial diversity is itself an educational value, and funds may be supplied or withdrawn as a college backs that belief in practice or falls short. Accountability of some kinds pressed so far against autonomy, against the freedom of the mind of the scholar, that tension, to go back to Arien, Mack, and Ken Prewitt's word, seems maybe too weak a word to describe the divergence. Scholarly autonomy, if it means anything, means that the individual scholar, answerable only to his peers, is able to give the law to himself concerning the nature of the work and how it is to proceed. The humanities have always been at the heart of university education. I think I'll say that again. The humanities have always, till now, been at the heart of university education, to the extent that our higher learning is something other than a boutique for professional training. And the accountability that matters most to a scholar of humanities comes from the force of tradition. T.S. Eliot said about tradition, you cannot inherit it, and if you want it, you must obtain it by great labor. As usual, omitting a certain element of play, that is, as usual for T.S. Eliot. A good deal of the labor of the humanities goes into allowing a tradition or some sufficiently representative understanding of a tradition to be passed on to students. You don't inherit American literature by being an American and deciding to write a novel in English. You may come to understand something about American imagination and participate in its traditions by taking, say, courses that assign generous readings in Jonathan Edwards, Benjamin Franklin, Madison, Emerson, Poe, Whitman, Frederick Douglass, Lincoln, Melville, Emily Dickinson, Henry James, Stephen Crane, Eliot himself, Stevens, William Carlos Williams, Du Bois, Dewey, Stein, Marianne Moore, Frost, Hemingway, Faulkner, Cather, Bellow, Ellison, Elizabeth Bishop, and let's stop there, because one of the great and gentle things about tradition is that it does not steal from youth their possession of their contemporaries as a thing precious to themselves and not yet settled. One bad thing about the humanities in our time is that we've stolen that pleasure from students in the effort by professors to re-enter the ranks of the young and teach contemporary culture hot off the press or the plasma screen. There is progress in the natural sciences, or anyway, there is advance to a subsequent interest that shows its persuasive results by testing a given approach against the resistant matter of nature. But there is no progress in the arts, and there is no progress in the humanities. This is a truth that we who teach these subjects are reluctant to repeat, partly for reasons of embarrassment, partly from causes connected with funding. The social sciences gained their credibility with some success by imitating the natural sciences, and the humanities for more than a generation now have tried to follow by imitating the social sciences. But I think there has been a separate source of this defect of candor, namely a failure of humility. The humanities, by their nature, are backward-looking. A proper defense ought to begin by acknowledging this and then affirm that the knowledge of the past belongs to a discipline of becoming fully human. William James, in his essay, Reflex Action and Theism, developed this idea with great richness and subtlety, and you must pardon me for the length of the quotation that's going to follow, but it's a matchless train of thought about education itself and the physiological demand to say it so that produces the morale of the scholar. I would like some water if it's available. I see it's over there. This is William James, to repeat from his lecture, which became an essay, Reflex Action and Theism, comes from, I think, 1881. The conceiving or theorizing faculty, says James, functions exclusively for the sake of ends that do not exist at all in the world of impressions we receive by way of our senses, but are set by our emotional and practical subjectivity altogether. This conceiving or theoretical faculty, he goes on, is a transformer of the world of our impressions into a totally different world, the world of our conception. And the transformation is effected in the interest of our volitional nature and for no other purpose whatsoever. Destroy the volitional nature, the definite subjective purposes, preferences, fondnesses for certain effects, forms, orders, and not the slightest motive would remain for the brute order of our experience to be remodeled at all. But as we have the elaborate volitional constitution we do have, the remodeling must be effected. There is no escape. The world's contents are given to each of us in an order so foreign to our subjective interests that we can hardly, by an effort of the imagination, picture to ourselves what it is like. We have to break that order altogether, and by picking out from it the items which concern us and connecting them with others far away, which we say belong with them, we're able to make our definite threads of sequence and tendency, to foresee particular liabilities and get ready for them, and to enjoy simplicity and harmony in place of what was chaos. I might translate that as saying, to enjoy education in place of what was ignorance. Is not the sum of your actual experience taken at this moment, present moment, and impartially added together, an utter chaos? The strains of my voice, the lights and shades inside the room and out, the murmur of the wind, the ticking of the clock, the various organic feelings you may happen individually to possess, do these make a whole at all? Is it not the only a condition of your mental sanity in the midst of them that most of them should become non-existent for you, and that a few others, the sounds I hope which I am uttering, should evoke from places in your memory that have nothing to do with this scene, associations fitted to combine with them in what we call a rational train of thought? Rational, because it leads to a conclusion which we have some organ to appreciate. We have no organ or faculty to appreciate the simply given order. Now, James, in that wonderful passage, is speaking of the artifice by which we seek an order in an external world that comes to us advertising no inward order of its own. Unity is created by us, never given by an existing state of things. And for that reason, we're bound to be creative in our most commonplace acts. We refine our understanding of the world by pulling together certain data and stimuli, by associating certain sights with certain smells, for example. But the faculty by which we do this is not mechanistic, but constructive and inventive. We work on nature as artists of everyday life and realize, that is, make utterly real to ourselves the aspects and conjunctures of the world that our experience wants to use. This is not a matter of experiment, but of function and survival. James goes on to demonstrate for his reader just how alien the world would become if we subtracted from it this figuration and shaping by the individual mind. The random, miscellaneous order of the world, he says, is an order with which we have nothing to do but to get away from it as fast as possible. This is James again. As I said, we break it. We break it into histories, and we break it into arts, and we break it into sciences, and then we begin to feel at home. We make 10,000 separate serial orders of it, and on any one of these, we react as though the others did not exist. We discover among its various parts relations that were never given to sense at all, mathematical relations, tangents, squares, and roots, logarithmic functions. And out of an infinite number of these, we call certain ones essential and law-giving, and ignore the rest. Essential these relations are, but only for our purpose, the other relations being just as real and present as they, and our purpose is to conceive simply and to foresee. Are not simple conception and prevision subjective ends pure and simple? They are the ends of what we call science, and the miracle of miracles, a miracle not yet exhaustively cleared up by any philosophy, is that the given order lends itself to the remodeling. It shows itself plastic to many of our scientific, to many of our aesthetic, to many of our practical purposes and ends. Turn back to the central sentence I just quoted, in which James addresses our ability to learn about the world. We break it into histories, and we break it into arts, and we break it into sciences, and then we begin to feel at home. On this view, academic study, or more broadly, intellectual inquiry, is far from the perverse or peculiar exertion that citizens of a business civilization take it to be. It's what we're almost born doing and compelled to do, and what scholars have the luck to go on doing more freely and with less specialization than others. By science, of course, James means knowledge generally, and he knows that the breaking of it into histories and arts and what we now call sciences is always arbitrary to a degree. It does not follow that the truths we're looking for are contingent, relative, infinitely malleable. Our point of entry is arbitrary only because it comes from the intensities of concentrations that have moved us to look closely at something outside ourselves and to convey what we thought we could see. That a thing happened or did not happen, that it occurred in this way and not in that, these facts matter to the imagination. It's a terrible mistake to suppose that accuracy is the enemy of imagination. Let me give an example now of a point of entry and path of discovery from my own experience, an in-school occurrence that happened by accident, as these things do. As an undergraduate, I read Perry Miller's great essay, The Marrow of Puritan Divinity, and was introduced to the tragic awareness by the second generation of New England Puritans of their falling away from the rigor and conviction of the first generation. About the same time, I read H.R. Trevor Roper's essay, The European Witch Craze of the 17th Century, which explored the literalism of the belief in the devil in Christian Europe and the sprees of panic and credulity by which whole communities could be turned against themselves or their neighbors. Some years later, teaching young Goodman Brown in an introductory course on American literature, I thought I could detect in Hawthorne's Fable signs both of the melancholy that Miller had diagnosed and the fever panic of mass psychology whose history Trevor Roper recounted. I knew also from reading Marion Starkey's book, The Devil in Massachusetts, about the Salem witch trials, that the characters Hawthorne's protagonist encountered on his hapless journey through the forest included the actual names of accused witches in Salem. So it seemed to me this famous story was not a fanciful tale of the haunting of a mind deformed by a native self-distrust. It was rather an ironic analysis of a historical predicament, the conscious faithlessness of an entire community which had produced a unique collective injustice in American colonial history. Now, these elements were present together only because of reading I had done at different times and the assignment to teach a difficult story that invited an allegorical interpretation. The interpretation didn't crystallize as a result of supervised research. It was rather an unpredictable convergence of knowledge or science drawn from various interests and readings. As it turned out, others better equipped to do justice to a historical view of the story were working at the same time on similar lines, and some such view of the story is now closer to common acceptance thanks to their labors. But in a small way here, I was a sharer in a discovery. The experience altered my sense of Hawthorne and perhaps of some other things, the morale of early New England, the capacity of human nature for self-deception. I relate this anecdote as typical rather than exceptional. It represents the kind of intellectual work we all do when we break up the given world into histories and arts and sciences. Sometimes we combine the elements unexpectedly. To say it like that may make it sound like a parable of the blessings of interdisciplinary work, but in fact, I don't think a scholar who claims to occupy two fields or more belongs to, or who belongs to an Arbeitsgruppe has better odds at making such a discovery than anyone else. And to emphasize a detail that's vital to my argument on tradition, the historical essays that spurred my reading were published a whole generation earlier. It would be hard to say what tendency either the historians or critics who came later were falling in with. So when I hear a teacher in the humanities say with disdain about some recent published piece, that could have been written 30 years ago, when the remark signifies not that the argument has been made before or that it's false, but that it pursues interests that must be foreign to us now, I know I'm listening to someone who thinks scholarly work is perishable in roughly the same way as a line of sports cars that has been superseded by a later line. The convergence of fashion and the wish to imitate science have recently produced the convergence of fashion with the wish to imitate science has recently produced in my own field the idea of distant reading. Close reading was a name for the use of the whole mind to interpret the verbal texture of great writing, a readiness to look in detail at individual words, phrases, sentences, paragraphs. It was a method that critics like Samuel Johnson and Samuel Taylor Coleridge had certainly known and practiced, but that had never been formally recognized as having special value. Mid-20th century criticism brought us that recognition. By contrast, the innovation of distant reading is made possible by the facility of computers at scanning thousands of texts and comparing the frequency of the uses of certain words and their proximity to other words with a thoroughness impossible to a human reader. The results have included a network theory-inspired diagram, for example, of the characters of Hamlet, and such inferences as the definition of a protagonist as the character that minimizes the sum of the distances to all the other vortices. And yet Hamlet is a document of human experience and not a sum of vectors and vortices. And to know what to look for, or even in the word counts, what to look for, you'd have to know the shadings of words and also, for example, the likely presence or absence of humor at a given moment, a kind of practical wisdom that the computer will not yield. The drive to imitate the social sciences has led to this sort of thing. Something similar was at work in the vogue of psychobiography in the 1970s and in the economics and law movement in the 1990s, and to some extent in the widespread influence of Michel Foucault. And I should specify the influence of Foucault rather than the work of Foucault himself, which is a more complicated phenomenon and a more subtle one. The best antidote to an impersonal excess is to have a friend or close associate who is intelligent without being academic. But this is lacking in the lives of many academics, and I notice the absence even in many graduate students. All their contact with things of the mind comes from professionals like themselves, and in that close company, it becomes impossible to translate out of the jargon. the professional surround establishes both the language and the content by which we know everything we can about things of the mind. The result is a loss of good sense and mother wit. A further cause of inhibition and self-limitation has been the rise of an academic avant-garde within universities. I'll repeat the phrase academic avant-garde because it sounds like a paradox. After all, in the 19th century, there was the academy in which painters like Couture and Delaroche and Bouguereau flourished, and there was the avant-garde constituted by rebels like Courbet, Manet, and Pizarro. The one excluded the other. But the humanities for a generation now have fostered an avant-garde that wields official authority inside the academy. This is hard to see for outsiders, and in the case of recent scholars, I believe it's hard to see for the academicians themselves. The sociological fact is hidden in some measure because their judgments in favor of their own work adopt a language that mixes scientific and aesthetic shadings. It is cutting edge, path-breaking, groundbreaking, the bearer of new methods, productive hypothesis, research programs that explore untapped resources of knowledge. I suspect a dim awareness of this mixture of scientific signals and aesthetic stance in the academic avant-garde is what underlies much of the bewilderment about the sort of work universities are subsidizing today. I mean the quantum of bewilderment that remains once we have allowed for and written off sheer philistinism, which in this context I would define as a distrust of learning for learning's sake. Yet it's a curious feature of the academic avant-garde that it too distrusts learning for its own sake. Scholarship is valued rather for the promise it supports of progress in the arts and in the improvement of society. At this point, an outsider of the humanities will want examples of the tendency I've been describing, and I'll draw mine from a recent article by Lisa Ruddock of the English Department of the University of Chicago, an article called When Nothing Is Cool, published in the online journal The Point. For her research toward a book on literary study, Ruddock interviewed 70 graduate students in this field, and she says two groups seem to have trouble adapting to the expectations they encounter. The first group, quote, bridle at the left political conformity and related attitudes from the culture wars. The second group, and these are the more interesting phenomenon and the more recent, quote, say that something in this intellectual environment is eating them alive. And she goes on to quote the head of an academic coaching service who also noticed this response and called it, quote, an immorality they can't put their finger on. An immorality they can't put their finger on. I would describe the immorality as, and this is me, but much influenced by her article and by years of witnessing this sort of thing, I would describe it as a defection from the work of judgment in an area where human knowledge, including knowledge from personal experience, ordinarily enters into judgment. One could almost say that knowledge from experience wants to enter and cries out when it's blocked. Ruddock believes on good evidence that this reaction has something to do with, quote, the game of academic cool, a game that's engendered norms that make ruthlessness look like sophistication, her words. And she cites a widely appreciated article on Jonathan Demme's film, The Silence of the Lambs. The psychotic murderer in that film, Buffalo Bill, tortures his female victims before killing them and wears a coat made of their skins. In the article, this character, the published article she's describing, this character is said to be the bearer of a post-human aesthetic, which is praised. His violence is found to disclose the truth that gender itself is, quote, always post-human, always a sewing job which stitches identity into a body bag. For the professor who wrote the article, the metaphor of the coat, among other details, clinches the argument. We've all undergone, and this is a mixture of Ruddock's paraphrase and her quotations from the article, we've all undergone a historical shift to an era marked by the destruction of gender binaries and of the boundary between inside and outside, an era in which not only gender but also identity proves to be skin deep. Ruddock concludes her summary in words that my own professional experience confirms, quote, I believe that when a scholar traffics in anti-humanist theories for the purposes of professional advancement,
His or her private self stands in the doorway listening in. When it hears things that make it feel unwanted, it can go mute. I've spoken with many young academics who say that their theoretical training has left them benumbed. After a few years in the profession, they can hardly locate the part of themselves that can be moved by a poem or a novel. The connection seems immediate here, this is me again, between the sacrifice of individual scholarly identity and the anxious placation of the demands of careerism. The branch of the humanities that's gone farthest to make a fetish of, quote, resistance and, quote, transgression has itself sponsored protocols of intellectual conformity as thoroughly routinized and regulated as any in academic history. Nonconformity has become hard to carry off in the choice of a subject as well as the mode of scholarly treatment. To repeat the unhappy phrase, you mustn't violate the way we think now. Two senior scholars whom my department was interested in hiring told me at different times that they'd looked over the list of all the dissertation topics of all the graduate students and none of them was any good. How did they know? Or rather, what did they mean? Good for what purpose and to what end? Clearly, they meant that the PhD candidates who went off on bad topics did not comport with the way we think now, and they would not land high-prestige jobs anytime soon. It's easy to see how such unchecked arrogance, whether in a department or a professional organization identified with a field of study, could lead to effects that are oppressive for the individual scholar. As a test of the present climate, let us compare the professional and bureaucratized manner I've been describing, a way of thought that aims to carry the torch for advanced thinking in our time, with the inward limitations of American higher education as it appeared a century ago, when the private colleges and universities and state universities and land-grant institutions had taken hold with sufficient solidity. Santayana left us a picture of that different climate in his lecture of 1911 on the genteel tradition in American philosophy, and by philosophy, he meant academic culture generally and the intellectual ethos of the universities. He called the reigning philosophy of 1911 transcendentalism and drew an ironic contrast between its remoteness and abstraction from American life and the uninstructed pagan self-assurance of the business civilization. What has happened, wrote Santayana, and I'm quoting from that well-known essay of 1911, what has happened is that the hereditary philosophy has grown stale and that the academic philosophy afterwards developed has caught the stale odor from it. America is not simply, as I said a moment ago, a young country with an old mentality. It is a country with two mentalities, one a survival of the beliefs and standards of the fathers, the other an expression of the instincts, practice, and discoveries of the younger generations. This division may be found symbolized in American architecture, a neat reproduction of the colonial mansion, with some modern comforts introduced surreptitiously, stands beside the skyscraper. The American will inhabits the skyscraper. The American intellect inhabits the colonial mansion. Little of this description fits the academic culture today. For a few years in the 1990s, the Graduate Center of CUNY was housed in a skyscraper with a view that would flatter the pretensions of firms like McKinsey or Google or Ernst & Young. Nevertheless, and it feels strange to admit this, the academic environment continues in other ways to be as remote as ever from the common morale of American society. And the effects of the estrangement now threaten a loss of public confidence in education, as well as a weakening of self-confidence among scholars ourselves. But what can the humanities, what could they, add to the utilitarian measure and instrumental value that recommends the natural sciences to society? Hume, in his essay of essay writing, divided the possible milieu of argument or discussion of intellectual matters into what he called the learned world and the conversable world. The learned world was, roughly speaking, what we would call today the sphere of laboratory experiment, the testing of hypotheses in areas like physics and natural history, then on its way to becoming biology, and chemistry, then on its way to being born. Men of science, in this sense, and Hume could feel sure they were always men, desired no contact with the literate public and would have found such exposure rebarbative because so small a portion of the public could understand what their arguments had at stake. On the other hand, for Hume, the conduct of public discussion on questions of taste, morals, and politics belonged to the conversable world. This encompassed the liberal arts in the freest and most general sense, and the knowledge necessary for someone to join the discussions was intricate, no doubt, but it could be acquired by a literate person over time without special instruction or assistance. The conversable world, as Hume saw it, was led by women, the opposite of the learned world of scientific men. It was led by women who, in fact, understood the arts of conversation better than men. And if the discoveries of the laboratory were ever to be conveyed to citizens whose suffrage and opinions must count in a free commonwealth, this would have to be done through the exertions of the conversable world. You'll see where I'm heading with this recollection and analogy. The humanities have long supplied our best approximation of a conversable world, and people come to know it most commonly through higher education. Yet the tone of the conversation, for us a somewhat slack all-purpose word for discussion, disputation, argument, conciliation, mediation, therapy, and many other things, the tone of the conversation can hardly be set with much inward affection by the academic avant-garde. The presumptively conversable who ought to have charge of the discussion have defected by adopting the manners of the learned. The exception proves the rule. We have a small and familiar body of academicians, the sort of people the British call media dons in the fields of politics and history preeminently, but not only there, who write articles and receive interviews that are broadcast for persons categorically less well-informed than themselves. They talk down to a polite audience. They are playing the role that Virginia Woolf characterized with unappeasable scorn in her essay, Middlebrow, a role of facilitators and middlemen. By contrast, those who work and teach in the learned world, that is, in the natural sciences, for their part have retreated farther inside the laboratory than ever and have found it expedient to entrust a great part of their teaching to novices who often lack the most elementary skills of pedagogy. These are intramural defects, some of them well known, perhaps on the way to solution, others clearly getting worse. There's no tendency, however, that has done more harm to universities and the ethos of scholarship than the legitimation of identity politics. This is, in fact, a form of anti-intellectualism. It sets out and enforces severe and censorial limits on any conversation in obedience to what are supposed the impermeable boundaries of nation, race, and religion, all the things that go together now by the collective name of culture. The strictures of cultural identity, as promulgated in the schools and in much current scholarship, are founded on a radical self-contradiction. We're trying to teach intense sympathy, or what most people now call empathy, but empathy literally means feeling your way into a life different from your own. The doctrine that we can only know and only be permitted to speak for our sort of people cuts away the very basis and possibility of empathy and makes a hopeless fraud of the study of society and culture itself. The abstemious practice that follows from this theory has cheated many students of the pleasure of thinking deeply about something besides themselves. An experiment in thought that is almost a necessity of life for an intelligent person, at least after adolescence. The grown-ups that proposed and built up or acquiesced in the addition of new layers to the identity bureaucracy have much to answer for. They have discouraged the inquisitive instincts that nourish education quite as much as the funding giants who demand to know the cash value of every course a student might take. Think hard about the fallacy. In honesty, we ought to concede it's almost as hard, in fact, for a young black person to imagine what it was like to be a slave as it is for a white person. And in the next generation, the same will be true for Jews trying to imagine what it was like to be an inmate in a concentration camp. No one has automatic access to imaginative truth by the mere virtue of racial or religious membership. A terribly wrong lesson is being taught here. To surrender the right to speak with authority outside one's own the surrender of the right to speak with authority outside one's own ascriptive group has led to the weakening of other freedoms. Civil liberties were still mainly a liberal cause in the 1960s and early 70s when I was in college. It pains me to recognize that this is no longer so. Few left liberals whom one meets under the age of 40 see anything wrong with speech codes. Words like hurtful and insensitive come to them easily in characterizing modes of speech that fall far short of denigration, insult, or threat. What causes led to this extraordinary shift? Herbert Marcuse, in 1965, broached a theory of the tactical uses of what he called repressive tolerance. The argument asserted that liberal democracy might be tolerant in its facade, but the sheer range of the available opinions in the marketplace of ideas actually served to conceal and exempt from critique the narrow range of views that counted as legitimate. Marcuse, in that essay, recommended a left-wing counteraction against the tolerant facade that protects the liberal industrial consensus. A properly radical movement of the time, he proposed, with students in the lead, should practice salutary repression of wrong opinions within their own milieu and indeed within their political control as far as it extended. Such a purified pattern of speech and communication might become the germ of a later and more truly tolerant society. This has come down to us in diluted form. The university, it is said, ought to be an epitome of what is best in the society, and this also means it must purge itself of all traces of what is worst. The demand falls in with the argument for salutary repression, with, as part of the regimen, available and prescribed programs of re-education, which are called sensitivity training. All this is done in the name of community. And in the week just previous to writing these sentences, I learned that Princeton University has recently constructed an array of affinity spaces for students from diverse cultural backgrounds, while Harvard has launched a university-wide task force on how to move, quote, beyond diversity to belonging. Community is the watchword here, the value most commonly cited in non-educational interventions in the cause of expanding and enriching education. And yet there is no value more depressing to the morale of a community of scholars than the imperative of belonging. It's one more injunction now uttered from far above the classroom, the laboratory, or the archive to cooperate with the way we think now. Is thinking generally done in the first person plural? Many have thought otherwise. The intelligence is defeated, Simone Weil wrote, as soon as the expression of one's thoughts is preceded explicitly or implicitly by the little word we. This corporate identity, whether belonging to a department, a profession, or one of the little platoons in society, has always been eager to enlist the thinker against his or her strongest instincts to adhere to the moral program, to adhere to the morale and program of the group, whether to advance the cause of progress or for the sake of brute loyalty. I think I like that phrase, brute loyalty, because loyalty is brutal. It was against just this call for synonymization of oneself with others that Emerson, in his essay, The American Scholar, defined the thinker as the person of all others who has the good fortune to live with integrity. Emerson was reacting against cliches of solidarity heated by nationalist sentiment, which closely resemble the appeals to cultural solidarity today. Yet he made his reply explicit against the division of thinking into subsections of labor commanded by the separate vocations and professions. Quote, man is, and Emerson's idiom here is a little archaic, but allow it for him. He's not William James. Man is not a farmer or a professor or an engineer, but he is all. Man is priest and scholar and statesman and producer and soldier. In the divided or social state, these functions are parceled out to the individuals, each of whom aims to do his stint of the joint work while each other performs his. By the way, this is written about 5 years before Marx's 1844 manuscripts, this parable of alienation and division. The fable implies that the individual to possess himself must sometimes return from his own labor to embrace all the other laborers. The scholar is thus pictured in Emerson's argument as a figure standing out against the background of partial citizens. They have suffered reduction and disfigurement in the name of commodity. They cannot escape their necessary compromises. The scholar thus forms the lucky exception and ought to make appreciable use of his or her good luck. Further with Emerson now, the state of society is one in which the members have suffered amputation from the trunk and strut about as so many walking monsters, a good finger, a neck, a stomach, an elbow, but never a man. Man is thus metamorphosed into a thing, into many things. The planter who is man sent out into the field to gather food is seldom cheered by any idea of the true dignity of his ministry. He sees his bushel and his cart and nothing beyond and sinks into the farmer instead of man on the farm. The tradesman scarcely ever gives an ideal worth to his work, but is ridden by the routine of his craft, and the soul is subject to dollars. The priest becomes a form, the attorney a statute book, the mechanic a machine, the sailor a rope of a ship. In this distribution of functions, the scholar is the delegated intellect. In the right state, he is man thinking. The nearly monastic poverty of young scholars in that age, Emerson takes to be a profound sacrifice. He calls it a cross. And so he's impelled to ask, what is the remedy for them, for scholars? And he gives this answer. They did not yet see, and thousands of young men as hopeful, now crowding to the barriers for the career, do not yet see that if the single man plant himself indomitably on his instincts and there abide, the huge world will come round to him. Patience, patience. End of quotation. One of our deeper troubles, I think, is that the speed of the new technologies and the metabolic response they prompt have made it harder to be patient. All the powers of modern culture and the state conspire to make it so. But it takes time for good work in scholarship to sink its roots. In the dissertations I've supervised or had a hand in supervising over 35 years, it's often been surprising for me to discover the scholar with a first chapter that struggled to find the definition of the topic or even to clear three consecutive sentences unobstructed by dutiful adherence to fashionable jargon and references, breaking through at last to a discovery from later reading and long thinking. And this is a blessing of libraries, too, known to scholars with a gratitude ordinary readers seldom know. It's the book next to the one you thought you wanted that proves to be the book that matters. In a field of study like most of the humanities, where rightness can seldom be proved by logic or quantitative evidence, but where nonetheless there are many ways of being wrong, strength comes from cultivating the virtue of wanting to tell the truth. And strange to say, that cultivation also takes time. I began today by quoting William James on the instinct for organizing a chaotic world of sensations and experience that underlies the arts and sciences and histories out of which we make ourselves a comprehensible world. I conclude with another passage from James from a talk to a Radcliffe alumni organization called The Social Value of the College Bred. I love that title, and I'll repeat it. The Social Value of the College Bred, as if it ought to have some value, but it's a question. What is that value? James there said that the humanities alone separate the college from the technical or professional schools. He also says straightforwardly something I've been trying to say by selective history and allusion, that the knowledge of a deep past humanizes. It gives us a consciousness of something other than ourselves and greater than ourselves, to which nevertheless we can speak and listen for an answer. By this means, our knowledge of the past creates a sort of civic good, which in a modern society based on convenience and technique is otherwise not available. Here is how William James puts it, quote, "You can give humanistic value to almost anything by teaching it historically. Geology, economics, mechanics are humanities when taught with reference to the successive achievements of the geniuses to which these sciences owe their being. Not taught thus, literature remains grammar or newspapers, art a catalog, history a list of dates, and natural science a sheet of formulas and weights and measures." James had no doubt that judgments of value lie at the heart of this humanizing knowledge. Quote, "The sense of human superiority ought then to be considered our line, as boring subways is the engineer's line and the surgeon's is appendicitis. Our colleges ought to have lit up in us a lasting relish for the better kind of man, a loss of appetite for mediocrities, and a disgust with cheapjacks. This labor of judgment he calls the sifting of human creations, the sifting of human creations. But is that aim of education consistent with our democratic requirement of tolerance and eventual trust in the majority, our hope of progress? So long as we believe that liberty, including liberty of thought and discussion, is not an enemy of enlightenment, I don't see how we have a choice. Thank you.
Well, that wasn't encouraging.
Was I discouraged, as Diaghilev did not say.
With respect to the future of scholarly knowledge. I guess I will start with one question. I will certainly open it up momentarily, but you described an awful lot of self-inflicted wounds, not imposed on us from the outside, but we're doing it, like the tyranny of the disciplines and identity politics and so forth and so on. But we are also us, you know. We are our universities. You're a Sterling professor, the most distinguished level of professorial status,
I think. It doesn't come from the name for silver. It comes from the banker and lawyer of J.P. Morgan.
Oh. Nevertheless, and there are other people in the room, I could point them out, major players in their respective universities, from Princeton, from Chicago, from Columbia, et cetera. So how do we, if we're them and we are the wounds are partially self-inflicted, what's the next step?
You want practical advice. One step that would encourage the sort of inventiveness I admire in scholarship and that I think is being strangled from inside as well as out would be a decrease and thinning of the layers of bureaucracy inside the academy. And that includes many bureaucracies, what goes under the name of human resources, the internationalization and corporatization of major research universities, and the diversity and sex bureaucracy as well. All of those, I think, all of these bureaucracies within the university contribute to choke off the sort of initiative that might gain public admiration. But it's true that anti-intellectualism has been a major force in American culture since the late 19th century at least. There was pro forma, affection for works of the intellect before that. Sad to say, but what we call populism, and I guess there's no better name for it, has a strong current of anti-intellectualism in it. So that part I don't know is curable. Here politics does converge with what we want to do with education from the inside. You need liberal-minded people who have control of what there is of federal support for education. But they must be people who don't want to intervene in the bureaucratic ways that just double up on what the academy is doing to itself on the inside. So I know that sounds rather general, but I hope there's some particulars that can be taken out of it. And I'm not an administrator, and so that end of things is not what you would have expected me to talk about, but it's not what I can talk about.
No, that's fine. No, I don't think that's an overly simple formulation. Just to repeat it, at least as I heard it, there are some things that are under our control. Not a lot of things that we wish were under our control, but there's some things which are under our control. And if we ourselves don't act on those, we can hardly expect to be in a position to have the respect of the external community so that they're going to maybe loosen up some of the kind of bureaucratic controls.
I think there is a relation between the bewilderment, the lack of respect, and the reluctance with dispensing funds on the outside, and things that have gone wrong inside the academy, but I think we ought to try to right ourselves just because that's the thing to do, not in the hope of gaining, you know, better purchase on, funding. But, you know, there are other problems which somebody like William Bowen or, you know, Andy Del Banco or people who've grappled a bit with the economics of universities these days, I think would be better equipped to talk about. It is a fact that graduate programs, for example, proliferated in the 1950s, 60s, and 70s to an extent that we can't support anymore. And I think there has to be some honest reckoning there, too. That, you know, many people who are senior scholars at major research institutions want to be empire builders in their own fields by producing PhDs who get jobs. That desire may go against, you know, any kind of honest treatment of aspiring younger scholars who don't have even the chance at the barriers of their careers that Emerson worried they might not have. I don't myself think that teaching graduate students is something in the stars for me, and that I'm being denied a natural right if I have to teach fewer graduate students, or in some years none. This may be the case, and it may be worth it in return for not holding out a false promise.
Well, I don't want to get down into the nitty-gritty of the financial model behind the university. We know all of, that's not where we want to go. We want to stick with the higher conversation. But I do want to, I'm almost tempted to call on people because I know people in the audience who
why don't you?
I will open it up in a second, but Akhil and Jonathan Fanton recently published a collected edition on academic freedom. And one of the key chapters, as I recall, Akhil, correctly, I hope, the internal tyranny, exactly what David was just talking about, the tyranny of the disciplines, the way in which, you know, the way we think is what we have to protect. Do you want to elaborate on that? Yes, you. Right? And I'm correct about the book, right? Wait a minute. Do you mind going to the?
I like the lights. If those could be turned down, but maybe they shouldn't be. I don't.
So, David, there's Richard Dawkins has this has coined this term meme to express in the cultural and intellectual sphere, in the sphere of ideas, something which replicates by analogy with the gene.
Yeah.
And hearing you speak about the easy ways in which ideas get obsolescent, in the remarks you made about how dissertation advisors now so easily say things are 30 years out of date and so on. And it strikes me that what Dawkins doesn't get is that unlike in nature, in human beings, there's this trait, which just simply has no analog in nature, that we get bored with things. There's no analog to that in nature. It's just a very deep fact about us that we get bored, which there just isn't in nature. So it would be very surprising if there was this replicative thing like the meme. We have a concept, which is the concept of a classic, right, which survives, but it isn't what Dawkins is seeking. He's not seeking some idea of a classic. He's seeking something which has productive capacities in ideas. And I'm just curious, when you repudiated this sort of tendency to plan for obsolescence in ideas, whether you were simply saying give respect to the classic, or were you actually seeking something humanistic, analogous to what Dawkins is seeking?
I'm not sure, because I haven't read Dawkins, or is it Daniel Dennett who also picks this up in some ways? Yeah. The case I was making was just for eccentricity, some randomness almost, or a chance for the unexpected affinity in choosing the works that turn out to matter to you. And obviously, people are going to write in a way that is in keeping with the ways of writing of their time. I mean, you can't decide to say things in a wholly different way and expect to be understood, and that goes for me too, for sure. But there's an intolerance or an exclusionism about forcing things into the mold of the present that I think, you know, lowers the value even of any possible work that people do by trying to force it into that mold. The graduate department in my field at Johns Hopkins years ago, 20, 30 years ago, was famous for having seminars on how to write up the same idea if you submitted it to this journal or this journal or this journal or this journal. I mean, this is you know, single party state kind of cynicism, but imposed in the name of, you know, shape it according to your plural possibilities. But the important thing is, none of it should come from you. There's no idea of an earnest commitment coming from the person who would want to stand behind it. And I think that's what is in danger of having lost. And it can relate to the, I'll just use that inadequate word again, the unexpectedness of some of the affinities one finds with earlier work or with earlier scholarship. There is a historian of art, of Mexican architecture, I think he was, George Kubler, who wrote a book, The Shape of Time, in which he talks about how tradition is not a continuous thing, but there may be in it what an art historian can only call something like broken sequences. So when Picasso picks up, you know, African masks and has his own vision of modernity shaped by that and paints Gertrude Stein in a way that is connected with things he's found from another civilization from centuries earlier, or, you know, when Eliot himself picks up the poetry of Donne and writes his quatrain poems in a way that's both modern and quite archaic sounding, you have an example of these broken sequences nevertheless being taken up. I think that's part of the freedom of both artistic and intellectual life. And so my protest, I guess, was, as usual, mostly negative, was a protest against people who want to shut that off and want to flatten things out too much. And I think that tendency in the academy is discouraging to see. I became a scholar chiefly because it seemed to me more free than other walks of life. And that seems to me the promise of it that one doesn't want to lose.
If other people were familiar, I'm going to call on one other person, but I'm going to give other people that might want to ask a question a chance to sort of get behind or get close to the microphone. We do want to record all of this, so we won't just take questions from where you're seated. But I was going to ask Rick Schwader from Chicago, back on the internal bureaucracy argument. I mean, protection of human subjects is a value. We would all agree. We shouldn't go out and do research which puts people who we are subjecting to our experiments and so forth at risk. Rick, however, has a position to argue on that, if you will.
I'd be happy to talk about it. Can I make a broader comment?
Yeah, all right, yes.
I want to start by saying that at the 100th anniversary of the University of Chicago in 1992, the chairman of the Board of Trustees got up and quoted Hutchins. And the quote was, at the University of Chicago, this is the chairman of the board speaking, the faculty is not working for the Board of Trustees, the Board of Trustees is working for the faculty. He said that. It was a nice thought. It seems to me to be less and less true, even at the University of Chicago. And I found myself resisting, Ken, the notion that the broader question about what's happening to the university and the academy is somehow separable from our concerns about the future of scholarly knowledge. I think David's reference to identity politics and what's happened on that front in and of itself is one measure of what's happened to the university. It's happened for a variety of reasons, some of which are associated with federal regulation yes. and affirmative action, which yes. is external. He's mentioned the potential threat to financing of the university that comes from particular external bureaucracies who have interests. We have more and more associate provosts at the University of Chicago than it's unbelievable, the amount
everywhere.
That goes. But all, many of them are dealing with regulatory environments, which is why they're there. And they have risk consultants who are sitting there telling them about how to play the game so that they're not audited, so that they don't come into public attention. So at some level, it does feel to me like money still does make the world go round. And when people in an institution switch roles, and I have many faculty colleagues who all of a sudden are on an IRB board, behave very differently than when they're complaining about it. And I know many people who become deans who all of a sudden have all sorts of constraints on them. So all of a sudden conversations emerge from top down about how resources are going to be distributed. And maybe we need to start counting bodies in classrooms so that teaching for profit now becomes institutionalized and has a kind of rational logic in terms of maintaining the financial health of the university. So it seems to me that all of these things, including the IRB, which, and I think David was suggesting, and I agree with him totally, that what's happened with identity politics creates an environment in which asking questions of certain types and having conversations of certain types ultimately spills over into scholarly research and the kinds of things that are going to be pursued because there are risks now associated with certain kinds of research projects.
Can I interrupt you just for a second?
Sure.
I think there's a double effect. Scholars are encouraged because they will be subsidized and because there's an external force pushing it to explore these subjects as a special a concern of the culture, the conversation, whatever. But at the same time, undergraduates typically are chilled. Mm-hmm. They say to themselves, "I don't go there at all. I'm not going to talk about."
Hmm?
Oh, I think a great, I'll say all but the active and energetic protesting students are chilled, feel relatively timid about entering into conversations about, for example, some issue to do with trans rights or with gay rights or with the rights of people of color. That's who's made timid. Everyone except the active and energetic of the protesting group, and that includes other members of the group. So thank you for asking for that clarification.
Yeah. Well, I was going to turn to another issue, which is the idea that we are in control, that we are the faculty. We should be able to do something about it. Within the last 2 or 3 years at the University of Chicago, there was a major debate in the Council of the University Senate with the administration over the question of how to interpret a single line in the Articles of Incorporation of the university, which says that the educational agenda of the university is in the hands of the faculty. The administration took the position that educational mission of the university refers to teaching, not to research. And the question of who controls the research agenda of the university is now increasingly being seized by the administration for reasons that I think ultimately relate to making decisions about what research is going to be fundable, patentable, is going to allow you to commercialize, and so forth. So it seems to me that and that of course affects questions about what areas to go into, who to hire, and so forth. So there's a kind of synergy, it seems to me, between the broader what's happening to the academy and the scholarly knowledge question. With regard to the IRB, which I think is a good example, it's quite clear that Socrates is not welcome on campus. I mean, with the kind of bureaucracies that have grown up, Socratic investigation would have to go through a compliance board before Socrates could ask a question which might lead someone, or a series of questions, leading someone down a primrose path to recognizing a contradiction in their own line of reasoning, which might frustrate and annoy them. you might not, you'd have to warn them in advance. Every question now at a university asked of an adult has to be approved by a administrative board, essentially an IRB. This is a huge shift. And it seems to me, and I'm going to talk about this in my own talk and the kind of effects it has on scholarly research in various areas, but who, you say, we have control. The faculty itself can't agree on these issues. In fact, as far as I can tell, the faculty, even at the University of Chicago, is fairly uninformed about some of these things as they go on. We've gotten to a point in which most of my colleagues don't even know there are minutes of the Council of the University Senate, which used to be distributed in hard copy in everyone's mailbox. So when you came to your office, there they were, you read them, you thought about the debates that were going on in the council. Digitalization arrived. They're no longer available that way. They're somewhere on some website, and nobody even knows where to find them or to read them. So the faculty, and of course, faculties have their own concerns, and they're very busy, and they have different views, even on the issue of the IRB. I would guess half the faculty thinks the protective, paternalistic role of an IRB is very important. We have to protect human subjects, while another set of the faculty feels that this is a deviation from free inquiry and dissemination of knowledge. But we have gotten to the point, without faculty, substantial faculty knowledge or protest, where the IRB bureaucracy reserves to itself, claims it has the right to tell you you can't analyze data you've collected. You can't publish it without our approval. This is a huge shift in what's happened at universities.
Sorry, I didn't.
Want to turn it into a question? Okay.
We're not going to be able to go on much longer, but I want to make, please.
I was wondering if we could return to the notion of knowledge, not from the outside, but from the inside. I was really struck by the fact that, I believe if I heard you correctly, you do not believe that knowing knowledge or doing processes in two different disciplines could produce anything better than being really deeply involved in one.
That couldn't be relied on to do that. Right. It being interdisciplinary doesn't mean you're wiser or going to make better discoveries because it's times two. Right.
However, your example with Picasso is precisely one of emergence, and so I'm curious if you are saying that interdisciplinarity doesn't produce new kinds of knowledge, or whether you feel that this is somehow disruptive of the traditions and the classics. So I was wondering if you could just expand on that a bit.
The more a scholar knows, the more paths of interest will lead to work that may be new work, that may be hugely inventive and interesting to many sooner or later. And what is true for a scholar and an artist, those two things are similar in that respect. Picasso wasn't being, he wasn't being an anthropologist and a painter when he took up these masks and began to incorporate some of the images drawn from them into his paintings. He was being a person using his mind, and a scholar is free to do that too. So I didn't mean to speak with prejudice against interdisciplinary ambitions. In fact, the example I gave, and I'm not particularly competent in history or philosophy, the two other fields of the humanities that I know anything about, but I gave that example of reading historical essays and finding them useful for interpreting a short story just because it was, as it were, accidental and impulsive. It didn't come from participating in a historicizing lab within literary study. It just came from thinking. And I think that happens all the time. Interdisciplinary work can encourage it, but in recent years, and especially because of the prestige of humanities centers in the 1990s, I was a director of one for 3 years, it seems to me that there's been an enormous valuation and hopes invested in interdisciplinary study as such, taking people from two different departments and having them teach a seminar about which neither of them is wholly competent, but together they pool their resources. I've done that myself. I've seen it work. And so this was not said to to, what to say, discourage the very idea of combining disciplines. But there's no such thing as the interdisciplinary philosopher's stone. It doesn't lead to, you know, path-breaking work, groundbreaking work, wonderful new methods automatically. And I think that the sense that it requires a commitment to two named disciplines and a foot in both departments, mm-hmm. and possibly a degree in both departments to license you to do that. That's the fallacy that I wanted to resist. Is that?
It does. I'm just also trying to connect it to this notion of promotion and review as well, right? So if you don't have a joint appointment and yet you're doing interdisciplinary work, it becomes much harder for you to actually be evaluated by your peers who may be traditionalized or classic. And so I can see the advantage of actually being able to converse and have ideas and conversations and be reviewed in those two different departments.
But
that's, I don't want to take up
that's an administrative consideration, and I would, you know, in any such case, I would want to know the details before judging what seems the best procedure. Yeah. In my experience, I have seen it work equally often, prejudicially in favor of the candidate that he or she is interdisciplinary. People judge it more lightly, more indulgently, and unknowingly, and they let things by, which they suspect are fallacious, that they wouldn't ever let by if they really knew the stuff. In my field, this is very prominent. You get the show and tell talk.
Right.
Somebody's talking about a work of literature from, say, the 19th century, and the person giving the lecture is the only person in the room who's read it. That person may get hired because it's, quote, new. And I think the same can be true in tenure reviews, too. But you're obviously right, and it goes back a long way, that, you know, a prejudicial resistance to work just because you don't know it, but qualified judges could be brought in if you tried, that can also work against a candidate. Yeah.
Thank you.
We're going to have just one more question, but not to beat the dead horse. If we take this interdisciplinary promotion seriously, we'll have an associate a provost who will be in charge of the rules by which we have to make that determination. Please?
Yeah, I want to ask you about your comment. I think it was you said, knowledge of a deep past humanizes. Did I get that correctly? Yeah. So I'm just thinking about it in relationship to my own recent experience. By coincidence, yesterday was a major Jewish holiday. And would you spend an entire day, if you're observant, in a synagogue reading ancient texts from a deep past over a course of 3,000 years by a series of very eccentric thinkers. I thank you for reminding me that the whole purpose of that day is to humanize, develop a spirit of contrition, humility, etc. So I'm just wondering now if what your thoughts are about our distance from the religious roots of the humanistic impulse in the academic world, and whether that might have something to do with the trivialization of the academic enterprise.
Well, the question is whether we have, tell me if I'm getting you wrong, the universities have suffered a loss partly from moving away from their, in many cases, denominational roots, so that there were occasions for religious meditation and so on within the universities, and that's the religious past of the major religions that have a long past is part of what
we're not taking religious thought seriously as part of the humanistic enterprise.
Yeah, I don't know that the universities can, of their own volition, decide to make religion more important to students than it is for students already. What they do is provide resources, not just in the form of chaplains, but in the form of departments of religion or of religious studies. Now, these departments are very often staffed by, among others, atheists. Can't be helped. If the atheists speak Hebrew, Greek, Latin, etc., they're well equipped to judge, you know, the liturgies of the ancient Roman Church or of the Hebrew Bible. Let me give you an example of something more everyday rather than concerned with a high holiday that is in my mind when I talk about a past. And let's not even talk about a deep past, but something quite out of the lingo of the present. we've lived with grandparents to some extent, if we've had the common enough good fortune to be exposed to grandparents who were brought up in a different way of life, and in my case, in one set of grandparents from Europe, from a different country, you get from that source a knowledge of the history of, let's say, half a generation before your birth, which seems almost as familiar as the knowledge you can have of the history of your own time, the time you've lived through. But it takes you some way back. It takes you some way back through anecdote, through feelings that color the anecdotes, through hearing people comment to each other, through the jokes they make, through the strong reactions they have. So that, for example, I was born in 1951, but I feel I have this sort of knowledge from oral history that goes some way into a medium past, as far back as, say, the Spanish Civil War. I know a good deal about that, and I would know what mistakes about that sound like because of this exposure. Well, I think that university education ought to be aimed at that sort of knowledge, but going farther back. The more it's swamped by the present, the more I think it just imitates the culture outside the universities, which is overwhelming enough anyway. And I guess that was, and in revising this for the journal Social Research, edited by Arien Mack, I should try to make the emphasis more prominent. I really meant what I said about the universities having been once comparatively monastic, and that perhaps not being a bad thing, to offer something quite different from what people can see any old day in the world outside. And I think the pressure, this is another internal one that wasn't imposed on us, the pressure to be au courant, to be quite a lot like the culture outside the universities, has introduced a false demand, or one we shouldn't cooperate with as much as we do.
So let's thank our speaker.